Today we're going over all the different types of manifolds, so digital, compound, four-port, and three-port, test gauges, and wireless test probes, and what their purpose is coming up. First up, we have our oldest style, really, is a three-port manifold, and so this is referred to as a manifold gauge set with hoses. And so there's three ports on the bottom. You have a low pressure side gauge, you have a high pressure side gauge. And so the high pressure side connects right over to this port. Even with these handles closed, the low side gauge connects right over to the low side port. And then you have your service port right here in the middle. If you open up your handle on the low side, it's going to connect the blue and the yellow, or the service port and the low pressure port together. If you open this one, it's going to connect the high pressure and also the service port right here. And so this was one of the originals, the original designs that technicians used in order to measure the refrigerant charge. And we usually had 5-foot hoses, but they also make 3-foot or 4-foot hoses. And these oftentimes came with hoses that did not have a low loss fitting. And so I highly, highly recommend that you get a low loss fitting if you're just buying, say, a 3-port manifold on the cheap. If you just have a hose end like this, it's just a basic design and there is no low loss fitting. So if you disconnect from the port of the system, it's going to allow all the refrigerant in the hose to blow out. And so you want to wear nitrile gloves, but basically have a automatic low loss fitting that you can add onto the side. You have a manual low loss fitting. So that has a ball valve that you can add. And then you have a valve core depressor, and this pushes in on the valve core in order to allow pressure into the hose. And then there's also a back seat position on this as well. It'll lock the refrigerant in the hoses for when you're disconnecting from the system. So you definitely want to have these added onto the hose ends, but you can just get refrigerant hoses like these. These are Hillmore ones that have the manual low loss valve on the end. And so they're built right onto the hose themselves. Our next example is a 4-port manifold gauge set. And so there is 4 ports on the bottom, and then there's also 4 valves. Now the purpose of this, like why this even exists, is to pull a vacuum through the manifold. And so the whole point, I don't really like to pull vacuums through a manifold. So I believe that there's a lot of potential for leaks. You're adding too many extra hoses, all of that type of stuff. But if you did want to do this, you would attach the vacuum gauge right down onto this port right here. This will be considered the service port. And so if you were charging refrigerant, you would be adding refrigerant in here. But what's happening is during your vacuum, you would add a 3/8 hose from here to your vacuum pump. You would read your vacuum level right here, and you would connect here and here to the system. Now that's a lot of hoses. It's a lot of possibilities for leaks and things like that. So make sure to follow what we are normally doing, which is just connecting the vacuum pump directly to the system via 2 hoses, and that's it. So for a 2-port system, it only requires 2 hoses in order to do a vacuum. Or on a mini split system, it's only 1 hose. In this case, you would end up having 3 hoses plus additional connection points right here. So really, the only reason a 4-port manifold exists, or the only purpose, is to draw a vacuum through the manifold. And so you don't really need to have that. The other thing that I wanted to point out is that on a manifold that's a compound manifold, such as this, that's a dial. A lot of people call them analog, but really we just call them compound. That means that the needle can go into the negative, into the inch HG marks, which are down in the lower green on this gauge, or they can go positive pressure in the blue. So that's what a compound gauge means. It can go into the below atmospheric pressure or above atmospheric pressure. So next, let's move on to the digital set. For a while, manufacturers were going towards making 4-port manifold gauge sets that are then digital. And so the positive benefit of having a digital manifold is that you can see very small incremental changes when you're doing a pressure test. Also, when you're measuring your pressure. When you're measuring pressure on a system, the error of a digital set is much lower than a compound set is. The other advantage to this is it has saturated temperatures built into this. So it has many, many saturated temperatures, whereas on a compound manifold gauge set, it only has, say, 3 saturated temperatures kind of built onto the gauge face, just painted on, really. But in this, you can select the different refrigerants to find the saturated temperature. This has a built-in micron gauge so that you can pull a vacuum through the manifold. But once again, I really highly recommend that you keep the manifold and the extra hoses off of the vacuum setup and also during the recovery setup. There's no need to pull old refrigerant through a good manifold when you're doing a recovery. There's just absolutely no purpose to that. The only thing that you need is just some type of a T or a Y fitting to connect the hoses to pull them together for when you're doing a recovery. So on this, you also see there's built-in temperature sensors in order to measure the temperature on the line. So you have your liquid line temp, and then you also have your suction line temp. And so what's nice about this is they have little calibration screws. So that's a big positive for a tool like this. And you can just adjust those to your 32 degree ice water to make sure that you do absolutely have accurate temperatures. And so there's tons of positives to digital sets. The whole point is that I tend to stay away from four-port manifolds. Now we move on to our three-port digital manifold set. And so I do like these. If you are adding refrigerant to a system, if you're just checking the refrigerant charge, this is kind of a nice way to do it, but you still are stuck with having to use hoses to attach to the system. And what we know about hoses is that when you connect and disconnect on various systems, you're going to have some of the old refrigerant oil in those hoses. And so you always want to have the hose ends closed off up against the ports to make sure that in between service calls, you don't have that hot, humid air allowing water to mix, like, you know, humidity in the air. So you don't want to allow water to mix with the oil in the hoses, because then really what you're doing is you're adding acidity contaminants into the next system that you're checking the refrigerant charge on. But anyway, on this, it's nice. You don't have to use this, you know, in order to pull a vacuum. It's just three ports. So you just would have your refrigerant bottle connected right onto here. And then you would attach to your high pressure side, your low pressure side, many different refrigerants that you can select the saturated temperature. And so the other advantage, something I didn't cover in the other manifold, is that you can automatically check superheat and subcooling, and you can also determine what your target superheat is, and you have various sensors on the other four-port manifold. So on this, you can use wireless sensors in order to determine your outdoor dry bulb, your indoor wet bulb, to determine what your moving target superheat measurement is in order to measure a refrigerant charge. What's nice about this particular model is you have this outdoor DB, so that's the outdoor dry bulb temperature sensor, already right here. And so it's built right on. You can also use these wired temperature sensors right here, temperature clamps, or you could use the wireless versions, just like this. And so this is pretty versatile. Like, this will do just about anything that you'd want it to do. The only thing is you are stuck with having to have the refrigerant in these hoses. So if you are just checking the charge and that's it, you're not adding refrigerant in, what's going to happen is that liquid hose is going to fill up with liquid refrigerant, which then, before you are disconnecting from the system, you have to charge that liquid back into the low side again, which means, number one, when you connect, you're going to have to still do your air purging process. And after that, you're going to then end up having to charge your liquid. Basically, you're going to disconnect the hose from the system with a manual bowl valve or automatic low loss on the end. You're going to have refrigerant trapped in here in your liquid line, and it's going to be fully liquid if the system's running. And then what you need to do is you need to charge that back into the low pressure side while the system's running. So you're still stuck with that. To avoid using hoses when you're doing just a check in the refrigerant charge, you could just use test gauges. Now, once again, now we're back down to just using compound sets. Now, in this case, you can see there's three saturated temperatures on the gauge face. These are not as accurate, anywhere near as accurate at all compared to the digital sets. And you got to make sure that they're set on the zero for atmospheric pressure before connecting them in. Now, the whole point of me showing you this first is just to show that you can avoid using refrigerant hoses, like when you're checking the refrigerant charge. And so you never have to have a hose on the high side at all. So if you are adding refrigerant into the system, you would just have that on the low pressure side, right? So there's no point in filling up a long hose on your high pressure side. And so once again, these are just a kind of an old school way to then also avoid using the hoses with these compound sets. The next thing that we could do is we could use something like this instead. So this is not only a wireless probe, but it's also a digital readout on the probe itself. And so you could mount this right onto the port, onto the vapor port and the liquid port in order to measure your pressure. It has built-in saturated temperatures right on the display. And you can also just see all of this on your phone. And so you have this. You also have something like this. Now, these are Refco ones. So you can buy these over at True Tech Tools that are available there. But right here, you have the display on the temperature clamp. So you see that right there? And so you can clamp right around the suction line, the liquid line. You can see the readout here, or you can choose to view it on the phone itself. You can use Field Pieces app or Measure Quick once again in order to measure the refrigerant charge. And you're not just doing that as well. You're measuring the system capacity. You're measuring airflow and other parameters basically when you are measuring the refrigerant charge. So you always want to make sure that you have the correct amount of airflow first before even bothering trying to measure superheat and subcooling. And really, we're measuring these out at the ports of the system. So really, you're measuring the total superheat and also the subcooling. And when you're measuring subcooling, it's typically on a system that has a thermostatic expansion valve. A thermostatic expansion valve looks like this. So we're measuring the subcooling on that, but we're also measuring our total superheat as well to make sure that this TXV valve is actually doing its job properly and holding the superheat around, say, 8 to 14 degrees of total superheat. But you can check out some of the other videos in reference to that. If a system has a piston orifice, such as this right here, you're going to measure your total superheat. And if your superheat's high, your subcooling's low, you know, you are low on refrigerant. Getting back to this, you can use something like this, which is a wireless probe, and also your wireless temperature sensors. And so when connecting these onto a system, it's very easy if you add something like this, little valve core depressing tool that has a back seat in it. And so you just back this right up just like that, and it locks any of the refrigerant that's in here from coming out. And as well, it's actually allowing the Schrader valve at the port to reseat. And that's very important. And so the whole point is that this gets connected to your probe first, right onto the side. And it makes it very easy for checking the refrigerant charge. So if you are connecting it onto your port, you would first make sure that this is backed up all the way. And then you're going to screw this in just like that. And then you're going to turn this in, and it's going to allow pressure to your wireless probe. And then you'll be able to see it on your phone or on your iPad in order to measure your pressure. And then when you're ready to disconnect, you just back this up. And then it reseats the valve core in here. And so you could take your time when you're disconnecting this. You're still going to wear gloves just to protect your hands from any refrigerant or refrigerant oil, but it's going to make it very nice to do that. Now, this is all you're going to need on the high pressure side. On the low pressure side, you could use this, something like this, or you could just add a T there. So a T like this. And what's going to happen is if you need to add refrigerant into this, you would just connect right onto here. There's a Schrader valve right in the end. And so you'd basically connect your refrigerant bottle to a hose, and then you'd have a manual load loss on the end of the hose, and then you would connect onto here. You'd purge the air out here before connecting, and then basically you'd be able to add your refrigerant right in here without any manifold. And so that's really important. And so a lot of times on the low pressure side, I'll just use a T like this. On the high pressure side, I'll use a valve core depressor like that. And so that's a method that you could use. It's always a matter of preparing your mind on what's going to be the fastest way to check the refrigerant charge. It's going to save a whole heck of a lot of time if you use test probes or test gauges in order to measure the refrigerant charge on a preventative maintenance call than it would be to add hoses into the mix and try to do air purging and charge the liquid in the liquid hose back into the system again. That's the whole purpose. It makes it really fast. It gives you the digital readout, say on your phone, on the app. When you include multiple sensors into an app, you can measure the capacity, the system capacity. And so it's very helpful and it's very quick. And so that's what I want you to kind of get out of today, is to think about potentially using wireless test gauges or test probes. So something like this, you could start off with something like this, and then you can move on to your digital ones. Like I said, for a pressure test, it's very, very important to use digital anytime that you're trying to see if you have a refrigerant leak. And you could, you know, use something like this. You see me teaching with compound gauges a lot. And the whole point is that most of the schools across the country are starting to teaching the technicians within their programs with compound sets because they're very cheap. After those technicians know how to calculate superheat and subcooling themselves, you know, within their minds, that's when you move into the digital sets that do those automatic calculations for you. It's very important that you as a technician can figure out total superheat and subcooling and the targets for those by yourself, because you could have batteries go down, you could have a wireless tool go down, and then you're up a creek. You have no idea what you're doing. And so it's very important. The other thing is to imagine the refrigeration cycle running like on top of the system that you're checking the charge on, and you can imagine what's happening in the inside while you're measuring the refrigerant charge. It's going to allow you to know if there's a problem, like a liquid line restriction, like a bad TXV bulb. It's going to allow you to know that you have a bad TXV or liquid line restriction and it's not a low refrigerant charge, or maybe it's low airflow and that's the problem. So it's very important for you as a technician in order to understand not only to check the charge and add refrigerant, but to troubleshoot as well. So I hope this video helped. And if you want to learn more about refrigerant charging or preparing a system for refrigerant or troubleshooting, make sure to check out A Refrigerant Charging, A Service Procedures for Air Conditioning book. And this is available over on Amazon and also at our website at acservicetech.com. We also have a 1,000-question workbook, and we also have quick reference cards. These quick reference cards can be used out in the field. They're made out of polystyrene. They hold up real well to the sun and refrigerant oil and heat and things. So you can keep these right in your service bag. And so if you want to learn more about HVAC, make sure to check out our website over at acservicetech.com, where we have a bunch of articles. We've got a podcast there. We have our quizzes. We've got calculators. We've got quick tips. So make sure you check all that out over at acservicetech.com. Hope you enjoyed yourself. We'll see you next time at AC Service Tech Channel.